I would like to thank our host that he gives us the opportunity to have a conference here in this beautiful surrounding, and we can enjoy the spirit of the house. Welcome to our conference on transnational societal constitutionalism. What does this enigmatic word mean? We are in Italy, so why don't we go down to southern Italy, to the coast between Napoli and Sicily, and be inspired by Greek, Italian mythology, Greek, Roman mythology. This is what is about our conference. Of course, you see this is Ulysses sailing home to his beautiful and faithful wife. And this is a very moment where the famous goddess and witch at the same time, Kirke or Church, had told him, "Let thy company bind thee hand and foot to the mast." It's here, right? "Let thy company bind thee hand and foot to the mast." With these words, Homer tells us in the Odyssey that the beautiful witch goddess Georgia had warned Ulysses against the sirens. Of course, we know what the sirens are. They were dangerous creatures, beautiful, bird-like seductresses who lured nearby sailors with their enchanting music and voices to shipwreck on the rocky coast of their island. But with cunning obedience, Ulysses followed Church's advice. Tying his hands to the mast, he saved not only his ship from wreckage, but he could listen joyfully to the sirens singing without falling for their deadly temptation. So it's not sheer survival, but higher degrees of freedom that we can achieve through self-restraint. Freedom through self-restraint. That is Ulysses' constitutional message. You all know John Elster, and he sent this message to the individual rational actor. He critiques the notion of economic rationality, although we are here in this house, maximizing the satisfaction of agents' present preferences. But Ulysses' message is relevant not only for the individual, instead it concerns the constitution of the whole crew, of the ship, even of the whole collective enterprise called Odyssey. In this collective dimension, Homer anticipates one of the strangest phenomena which emerge in the modern nation states' political constitutions. The deadly temptations of power are not overcome by external restraints. Instead, power needs to restrain itself. Self-limitations of power, here lies the historical success of nation-state constitutions. Checks and balances, division of powers, procedural constraints on decisions, constitutional rights, more recently, eternity clauses which block the democratic majority from abolishing human rights and democracy. But this is not yet the theme of our conference. It begins here. If you look closer to Waterhouse's painting, you realize that there is not only one siren attacking Ulysses' ship, but a sheer multitude of sirens. It was the great error of state centrism in constitutionalism to perceive only one temptation, the excesses of state power, and to turn a blind eye to the manifold other siren temptations. It's not only Telxiapeia, but also Molke, Aglia Perfonos, Persistito, Parteno, Perigea, Leucosia, Rhine, and Telos. Was that right? Who are trying to lure Ulysses' crew with their seductive voices. Constitutional dangers are not only created by state power, but equally by money, knowledge, technology, medicine. Today's great constitutional conflicts are not only about the state constitution, but about the many constitutions within society. The battlefields are the global constitution of the financial economy, of science, technology, of the new digital media. Postmodern society is exposed to expansive, even totalitarian tendencies of a whole variety of partial rationalities. Monetarization, commodification, scientification, juridification, medicalization. These are the names of the sirens today. So this is where Michel Foucault's capillary power creeps in from the different institutions and discourses of society, not just from the old capital power of the state. It finds its constitutional reaction in Jacques Derrida's concept of capillary constitutions, of the many discourses in society. To be more concrete, during the last few years, a series of public scandals has raised the new constitutional question. Multinational corporations have violated human rights. The World Trade Organization has made decisions that have endangered the environment or human health in the name of global free trade. There has been doping in sport and corruption in medicine and science. Private intermediaries have threatened freedom of conscience in the internet. There have been massive invasions of privacy through data collection by private organizations. And recently, with particular impact, global capital markets have unleashed catastrophic risks. Each of these scandals poses not just questions of an external regulation by the state, but of internal, of capillary constitutions of these transnational regimes. Where exactly lies the constitutional challenge beyond the nation state? Homer tells us the Cyrene's temptation lies in what I would call collective addiction. Collective addiction. As Walter Copland Perry observed, quote, "Their song, though irresistibly sweet, was no less sad than sweet, and lapped both body and soul in a fatal lethargy, the forerunners of death and corruption." So the siren's irresistible temptation to perform social activities in spite of their self-damaging consequences. And this is not only individual addiction, but predominantly social temptation of the whole crew sailing toward the rifts. Social addiction cannot be healed. This was the great error of Karl Marx. It remains forever, but it can perhaps be domesticated by constitutional self-restraints. Which addiction mechanisms are responsible for the fact that the autopoietic self-reproduction of several social sectors through the recursivity of system-specific operations reverts into a communicative compulsion to repetition and growth, bringing self-destructive consequences in its wake? This is the constitutional question of our time. Waterhouse's painting grasps one moment, the dramatic moment, the constitutional moment. There's nothing necessary about the catastrophe, as Karl Marx postulated, and nothing necessary about Max Weber's iron cage of modernity. Niklas Luhmann is more plausible. The occurrence of the catastrophe is contingent. It depends on whether countervailing structures will emerge which prevent the positive feedback catastrophe. The constitutional moment is not yet the moment when the self-destructive dynamic makes the abstract danger of a collapse feel. Rather, it is the moment when the collapse is directly imminent. This is the moment of crisis in the collective addiction, the moment where collective energies are released, the moment when Ulysses' cunning strategy of self-binding actually works. Societal constitutionalism identifies those constitutional moments not only in politics. 1945, when the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights was accepted worldwide after the atrocities of totalitarian regimes. In functional differentiation, all subsystems of society develop those massive growth energies which are excessively ambiguous in their productivity and in their destructive character. Constitutional moments occur in many sides of global society. We have experienced constitutional moments in the global economy. 1929 and 2008, when the collapse of powerful banks triggered social movements for a worldwide financial constitution. Recently, science and technology, perhaps, had their constitutional moment in 2011 when Fukushima signaled the limits to the expansion of nuclear industry. Even the so-called humanistic discipline of medicine experienced a moment, 1943, when a Dr. Mengele performed human experiments on concentration camp inmates, including children. And we are waiting for the constitutional moment to occur in the digital world. Google's and Facebook's data manipulations sound like early warnings. Exogenous self-binding. This was Ulysses' constitutional strategy. Obviously, this is a paradox. How did he overcome the paradox? The internal self-binding of the sovereign's will triggered from the outside. A twofold externalization seems to show the way out for constitutionalism. Church's magic authority created external learning pressure for Ulysses' self-restraint, and when he delegated the bindingness of his promise to the crew, he blocked his own urges to unbind himself from his pre-commitment.
Externalization combined with internal self-reflection. These are for us the necessary and indispensable conditions to transform the experience of crisis into a stable constitution. One thing has to be clear though, societal constitutions do not arise out of the intrinsic voluntary motivation towards self-limitation. We would say to the contrary, predicting that transnational regimes voluntarily develop limitative rules would imply a false idealism and considerably overestimate the potential of self-regulation. Although being the only competent authority to introduce the self-limitation, we realistically predict that regimes rather resist any form of self-limitation that prevents them from growing. This, what we would call the competence-motivation dilemma, can only be solved when a specific interaction of the regime with its environment takes place. What is needed is firstly, sufficient external pressures exerted on the regime, which secondly trigger the process of internal self-reflection and limitation, that is then thirdly externally stabilized. As to the first condition, societal constitutionalism can only work when sufficient external and equally important internal pressure is generated on the regime to force it into a self-restricting process. In reality, we would consider such pressure coming from primarily NGOs, labor unions, intellectuals, but also political institutions, and not to forget the threat of legal liability. To take a concrete example, the codes of conduct developed by multinational corporations that contain explicit commitments to human rights, workplace standards, and the natural environment did not in its current form appear out of nowhere. It was in fact strong pressure by NGOs and labor unions and consumers that forced the corporation to restrain the negative side effects of their worldwide operation. In the end of the 1990s, NGOs discovered scandalous working conditions in garment factories in developing countries and initiated a debate about human rights violations in the apparel and footwear industry. They disclosed impressions from secret factory visits on the internet and launched them to the media, famously campaigning for no logo, with the result of serious reputation damages for companies in the specific sector. In addition to NGO pressure, a change in the attitude of market actors could be observed. Consumers seem to pay considerably more attention to the production process and the social performance of a company. Keywords, consumer boycotts, buying with a conscious or socially responsible investment. The Fair Trade Labeling Organization, which is an umbrella NGO that certifies products grown or manufactured under fair labor conditions, observed roughly a triplification in sales in their own certified products between 1997 and 2003. Corporations frequently introduced these codes of conduct and commenced to participate in fair trade regimes primarily as a response to these things. We can, of course, discuss how successful these external pressures are, and I'm sure that this will be also subject during this conference. But why do we still then advocate a form of self-limitation and not a transformation of these external pressures into genuine political intervention? Critics would, of course, insist that past experience shows that self-limitation following societal pressures merely serves to set the fox to keep the geese, and inevitably leads to new excesses and escape from effective self-limitation. The wide critique on the soft and vague or unenforceable character of the corporate codes is a prime example in that respect. This is a valid point, but does not experience equally show that attempts to externally control internal processes to intervention regularly fail due to the lack of knowledge and competence of external authorities in respect to the regime at stake? It is, in this concrete example, the organizational closure of transnational cooperation that prevents politics from effective intervention. Politics and law, however, still play a crucial role in societal constitutionalism. Schirke's advice: the intervention may reach the regime in form of indirect impulses and recommendations and may be taken up within the process of self-reflection. In relation to the codes of conduct, I would consider such external irritants indeed a cornerstone of the constitutional process. And they can, I would say, consider it to be at least partly successful. First, the corporation's initial codes were criticized for being vague and simple window dressing. But then, in order to render the courts trustful sources of self-limitations, corporations increasingly included external standards in their courts. Today, the standards laid down in the ILO for labor conventions, for instance, are main sources of inspiration, and in some courts explicitly referred to. And corporations, admittedly in some sectors more than in others, indeed feel the need to adopt and deal with externally crafted codes and partly politically initiated multi-stakeholder initiatives. Prominent examples, I would say, are the UN Guiding Principles for Business and Human Rights, or what Larry Becker will also talk about, the Fair Labor Association. But even though societal forces exert massive pressure on the expanding regime and direct it towards a constitutional process, we argue that the constitution may only arise, and this is the second condition, when the regime itself produces the internal self-limitation. Although corporate commitments to human rights, workplace standards, and environmental protection did only arise due to the constant pressure, the necessary content, structure, and internal operation was to be developed by the corporation itself. It is the only authority capable of regulating the organizational structures and processes, controlling the operation abroad, and effectively negotiating with suppliers on contractual relations. Sector-specific differences have to be taken into account. But there are also great differences in the individual company steering mechanisms and in the way in which environmental and social objectives can be included and monitored. Hence, the knowledge of how to set up and implement self-limitative rules lies hidden in the regime itself. But even a successful process of self-limitation alone is not likely to become a stable constitution, unless the paradox of exogenous self-binding, Gunther already referred to it, the will to be bound against one's will, is overcome. In other words, how can self-limitation be upheld when the experience of danger fades and temptation becomes overwhelming again? Ulysses externalized his will to his sailors, who he ordered to disobey and leave him tied to the mast regardless of how much he would beg for release. In relation to societal constitutionalism, this, as a third condition, implies that the self-limitation has to be backed up by an external constraint. There is a hope that the spontaneous sector of civil society may not only use pressure as a continuous medium to force the system, the regime to stick to the rules, but also becomes professionalized and develop autonomous rules to watch over the self-limitation on a continuous basis. In relation to corporate codes, it can at least be observed that NGOs and labor unions do not only pressurize corporations into adopting the codes, but also take over the function of monitoring code compliance. Today, the monitoring and internal complaints procedures are actually often handled by NGOs or professional private authorities. But in addition, corporations more frequently are forced to revert to traditional legal mechanisms in order to render the codes binding. They increasingly publish the codes in their annual reports or include them in their contracts, with their suppliers. Since annual reporting, market behavior, and contracts are all guaranteed by legal norms, the legal system may consequently also function as a core society force externalizing itself. This renders the law pivotal in respect to the success of society constitution. Law's central role is then to create a binding effect which resists temporary urgence of the corporation to give in to the temptation. Hence, societal constitutions do not only have to be reflected within the corporation, but also initiate a reflexive process within the law that provides for and hereby de-paradoxifies the self-binding character. The existing relations between law and the regime of transnational cooperation would then need to be expanded and enriched with a constitutional dimension. This implies, amongst others, further developing the legal institutions of corporate governance, competition, or contract. A process of internal self-reflection stabilized by external societal forces and triggered by them, which commences in the very moment where the catastrophe is faced and felt. This is our message on societal constitutionalism. We are looking forward to an exciting and fruitful conference, and I'll give the floor to the first chair.